Lord this morning. Amen. Let's all grab our hymn books, and if you're able, would you stand and turn to page 627. 627, Jesus is the sweetest name I know. To page 107, 107, no, not one, 107, 107, no, not one. Sing it out this morning. Thank you.
think we don't do enough of taking it to the Lord in prayer. And when we fail to do that, then we get discouraged and we don't get the help that we need. We were looking at John the Baptist in Sunday school, and I was just thinking about that, singing the song. When he doubted, who did he go to? Jesus. He sent his disciples, but, you know, and he went right back to the source. Are you the one, or should we look for another? And Jesus didn't scold him. Jesus didn't, you know, send word back. You go tell John the Baptist he's a doubting, foolish man, and I can't believe that he would doubt who I am. No, he sent him back and said, you tell him all that you saw me do here, healing all these people, saving souls. And he reminded John the Baptist that indeed he is the Messiah. And then he turned around all the people that were standing there and said, hey, y'all, do you realize that there's none greater, no prophet greater than John the Baptist? And so we definitely serve a gentle, loving Savior. Amen. All right, praise the Lord. Let's have a word of prayer. Good to see everybody out this morning. Glad you came out to worship the Lord for us, with us. It's been a warm week. And these temperatures. How many of you work outside with your daily job? Wow. Amen. And so it feels good in here right now, I'm sure, to you. And some say, Brother Tim, it's kind of warm in here. I'm thinking it's not as warm in here as it is out them doors right there. But praise the Lord. You know, we're very fickle creatures. When it's freezing outside, we want it to be warm. When it's warm outside, we want it to be cold. And we're trying to be spiritual. Jesus said, I'd rather you be hot, you know, than cold. Amen. And so, but God's good. Hey, let's pray. Ask the Lord's blessing on the service. Glad y'all came out to worship with us. Brother Jody, would you lift us up to the Lord in prayer? Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Just a couple of announcements here. How many of you celebrated a birthday today or in the past week? Any birthdays? We got some fresh, hot off the market Chick-fil-A gift cards. Brother David had a birthday. Amen. Who else? Let's see. Brother David, how old did you turn, brother? 85. I doubt it. Well, you can. I mean, is it that big of a deal, brother? Amen. Okay, amen. All right, well, I don't want to offend my brother, so I think he's like 32 or something, but amen. He did a thumbs up on 32. All right, Brother David had a birthday, and anybody, Corbin had a birthday? All right, upstairs, Corbin had a birthday. Brother Chad, give that to Corbin. And anybody else, birthdays today or in the past week? Let's give these a birthday hand, amen, praise the Lord. Very good. All right, let's see here. Also, we had a wedding anniversary recently, and Brother and Sister Robert celebrated a wedding anniversary, Brother Randy and Miss Deborah, and we want to give them an anniversary hand this morning. Brother Randy, how many years? 18 years. Brother Randy, where'd you meet Miss Deborah at? Where at? Vacation Bible School? Oh, CVS. I was like, man, he was at VVS and got him a wife out of the deal. all right, CVS. All right, so you were hitting on somebody in the pharmaceutical department, I'm assuming. And here they are today. So let's give Brother Randy and Miss Deborah a happy anniversary hand. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, amen. Hey, listen, a couple other things here, church. If you would, keep Brother Clay Kilpatrick in your prayers. He reached out to me this morning, and he's in a lot of pain right now. He said, Brother Tim, he said, I can't lay down. He said, I can't sit down. He said, whether I lay down or I sit down, he said, my body's in excruciating pain. He said that he went to urgent care, and he said they diagnosed him with, I've never heard of this, but something called piriformis syndrome. I may be pronouncing that incorrectly. I'm not sure. Never heard of it, but he said, please pray for him. And Clay's one of those guys, like most of you men in here, typically we wake up with an ache and pain. We just, you know, we don't mention nothing about it. And for Brother Clay to say something about it, I can guarantee you he's hurting. So keep Brother Clay in your prayers. I told him we would mention him. And then also, if you would, keep Brother Austin's family in your prayers as they go through this time of mourning. His grandmother passed away this past week, went home to be with the Lord. And she was in church on Sunday morning. I mean, literally in church on Sunday morning, sat by Miss Deborah, and on 4th of July, went home to be with the Lord. And so, church, you just reminded me this week. I mean, we never know what a day may bring forth. We could be sitting here right now this morning, and everything's okay. Your heart's beating in your chest. You're breathing this wonderful air God's given us to breathe, and we might not be here by Wednesday. And so, why do you say that, Brother Tim? You trying to be morbid? No, I'm just saying this. Don't take it for granted. Tell your family you love them. Tell your wife, your husband you love them. Hug your kids. Well, we just don't have that kind of relationship, preacher. You need it. You need it. Grab them and hug them. Tell them you love them. And church, we never know. And so praise the Lord, Austin's grandmother. I was at her house 2 weeks ago. Had been meaning to go by there and just delay, but got to go over there, sat down with her right there on the couch. I was there for a solid hour and a half. We had a great visit. She gave clear testimony of knowing Christ as Savior, and just had a good time rejoicing in the Lord there in her living room. But keep Brother Austin and the family in your prayers. And service is Friday, Brother Austin. And so pray for the service, that the Lord would use his word to speak to the hearts of those that are there. No doubt, just like at every funeral service, there's people there that don't know Christ as Savior. And so just pray the Lord will speak to their hearts. All right, very good. Let's see here. Good to have some visitors this morning. Good to have Miss Sarah visiting and from Canada. And this is Miss Tricia and Josh's friend. And so from Canada, good to have Sarah visiting. Let's welcome Sarah to the service this morning. Amen. Always good to have visitors. Glad you came out to worship the Lord with us. Our missionary family of the week, if y'all would, church, keep the Shelby family in your prayers there to Kenya, Africa. Pray for them as they serve the Lord there in Africa. And then also, a couple things on your bulletin. If you didn't get one, they're on the entry table. Digital one on Remind, if you get the Remind app. Ladies, y'all going to have an ice cream social. I guess that's where you socialize and enjoy ice cream at the same time. And so ice cream social, July the 16th at 6:30 p.m. Please let Miss Opal know by the 14th if you'll be attending so she can have enough Bluebell ice cream for everybody there. So, what about the men? amen. Guys, we'll pray for the ladies that they have a great time of fellowship and enjoy the ice cream. So, ladies, y'all come out. You have a good time. It'll be fun. And so you'll enjoy the fellowship. So be here for that. And then our creek baptism scheduled for July the 28th. We got a handful of folks we're going to be baptizing. I'm excited about that. If you've never been scripturally baptized, let me know. We'd love to get you on the lineup for that. Brother Steve Brandon, is Brushy Creek still a go? Check the weather. Will do. Amen. Okay. All right. Check the weather. We may need some of these guys 4x4s to get us back there. So they'd be happy about that, I'm sure. Weather permitting, July the 28th. Hey, listen, we're going to have a creek baptism. If you've never came out with us, some of you leave after the service, I want to encourage you to just drive out there with us and follow us. It's a special time. I've really kind of taken a liking to this creek baptism, Brother Steve. I'm serious, brother. I really think it's special. Amen. And so it's a blessing. And so come out and join us for that on the 28th. We'll basically have our creek baptism service, and then we'll be done for the day. That's on the 28th. And then YouthCon will be here for you know it. I want to say thanks to all the parents that gave towards that. If you haven't paid your registration or your YouthCon fees, young people, please turn that in. Young adults, get that turned in, and we'll have a good time at YouthCon. Okay, that's all the announcements. Hey, let's stand, turn around, shake a few hands. Choir, you make your way down front.
right, church, as you make your way back to your seats, the choir will prepare to sing, "Come, Holy Spirit."
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Hey, listen, church, one more anniversary. We needed to recognize that I forgot. Brother and Sister Dugan had a wedding anniversary recently, and Miss Sarah and Brother Nick. And so we want to recognize them as well. Miss Sarah, how many years has it been? 18. Wow, together. Amen. And praise the Lord. And Brother Nick's probably at work this morning, and he's a hardworking man. Let's give Miss Sarah and Brother Nick a happy anniversary hand. Amen. Praise the Lord. We need to recognize biblical marriage in this day we live in. And man, there's all sorts of stuff going on out there, but we want to recognize biblical marriage between a man and a woman. Amen. All right, Numbers chapter 13. Turn there with me this morning if you got your King James Bible. Numbers chapter 13. While you're turning there, many of you know the story about Peter when he was... The Lord called him to come to where he was at there on the water. And Peter was walking on the water. You know the story. You've heard it 100 times. But what was it that caused Peter to begin to sink? What did he do? All right. We often say that. He took his eyes off the Savior. But what did he put his eyes on? All right. What he was afraid of, right? He started looking at the water that was beneath his feet, okay? And so, I think in our life spiritually, we don't remind ourselves enough that if we're not careful, what we put our eyes on can have a negative impact on our life as a believer. And we could find ourselves making some decisions and doing some things that we ought not to do, all because we started looking at something we should not have looked at. And I think we'll see that here with the children of Israel in Numbers chapter number 13. God's children did that here in Numbers chapter 13. And hopefully we can learn from their mistake and avoid doing the same thing in our walk with God each and every day. And so Numbers chapter 13, if you found your place and you're able, would you stand with me? We're going to read just a few verses here. Many of you know the story we're going to be looking at. This is a great text. Numbers chapter 13. Go down to verse number 17. And Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said unto them, get you up this way southward and go up into the mountain and see the land, what it is, and the people that dwelleth therein, whether they be strong or weak, few or many, and what the land is that they dwell in, whether it be good or bad, and what cities they be that they dwell in, whether in tents or in strongholds. And what the land is, whether it be fat or lean, whether there be wood therein or not, and be of good courage, and bring of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes. So they went up and searched the land from the wilderness of Zin unto Rehob, as men come to Hamath. And they ascended by the south, and came unto Hebron, where Ahiman, Shishai, and Talmai, the children of Anak, were. Now Hebron was built 7 years before Zoan in Egypt. And they came unto the brook of Eshcol, and cut down from thence a branch with one cluster of grapes, and they bare it between two upon a staff. And they brought of the pomegranates and of the figs. The place was called the Brook Eshcol because of the cluster of grapes which the children of Israel cut down from thence. And they returned from searching of the land after 40 days. Now, I know most of you in here have read this text. You know it very well. And I hope this morning we can see a little something different in it and really see what the children of Israel, who they had their eyes on versus where they should have had their eyes, their focus at. And I want to preach a message entitled, Get Your Eyes Off of Your Giants. Get Your Eyes Off of Your Giants. Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you for Christ, our Savior. Lord, thank you for your word. And I pray, God, that you'd speak to hearts today like only you can. We pray, Lord, that you would just be glorified in everything that's said and done. Lord, as we consider the text that's before us, I pray, God, that you would give us wisdom. We ask you to give it to us liberally, Father. Help us to understand. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Now, you recall the story of the 12 spies that went over. How many of them came back with a good report? Two. How many came back with a negative report? Do your math. 10. Very good. Very good. You are promoted to the next grade level. And so 10 came back with a negative report. Two had a positive report. And many of you know the story very well. However, this morning, I want you to really examine with me the details of what took place in this Bible account that we have here. The details of how God providentially led them. God providentially ensured that they tasted of the goodness of that land that was before them. God providentially ensured that the giants did not hurt them while they were over there. And then after experiencing literally the blessing of God, tasting the blessing of God, enjoying the goodness of God, the persuasive power of just the... Don't miss this. This is really... You can't go home after I say this, but this is the whole message. Just the appearance of the giants, the persuasive power of the appearance of the giants in their hearts and minds led them to missing out on the best that God had for them. Just the appearance, right? Nothing happened to them just because they saw them. And I want us to look at the details in the text this morning. Maybe you're here today and you've been paying too much attention to the giants in your life. Listening to the giants in your life. I believe that there's times we could be one decision away from forfeiting God's best in a certain area of life. Forfeiting the great blessings of God. That's not to say God's not going to take care of us. God took care of the children of Israel. Well, they died in the wilderness, but God took care of them and He was there for them even after they doubted Him and did not believe Him. But in our life as a believer, we've got to be very careful to keep our eyes off of the giants. Because if we look at them and we pay too much attention to them, we may make some bad decisions. So let's look at this text here. Notice verse number 17. It says, And Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said unto them, Get you up this way southward and go up into the mountain. Now, Moses gives the Israeli spec ops group their marching orders, tells them what they need to do. They head out on this top secret mission. I mean, he tells them, basically, I need you to go out and get a salute report, find out the size of the unit, find out the activity that the unit's engaged in, find out the location of the unit, find out exactly what their uniform or the unit, how they appear, what they look like, find out what equipment they have there, go out, find out all this information, 40 days, find this out, and then I want you guys to come back and let us know what you discover. Verse number 18. He said, See the land, what it is, the people that dwell therein, whether they be strong or weak, few or many, and what the land is that they dwell in, whether it's good or bad. He says, I want to know everything about it. Verse 20, what the land is, whether it be fat or lean, whether there be wood therein or not, and be of good courage and bring of the fruit of the land. And so he sends out this group to spy out the land. Now, sending out a forward operating group in the military is nothing new. And often our soldiers are tasked to do that, and they're to bring back a salute report and to come back and report all that information back so that our military force can, you know, handle the situation that's before them and be successful, be victorious. Now, notice in verse 20, Moses even tells them to be of good courage. Think about it. He's saying, hey, guys, listen, you got this. Keep your chin up. Keep your head up. Keep marching forward. Be courageous as you go out on this this special ops mission. And I mean, no doubt they knew that they believed that the Lord was going to take care of them and be with them as they head out.
And Moses, you know, he did not choose the scrubs that were in the unit, okay? He didn't choose the soldiers that couldn't make it to formation on time. He didn't choose the soldiers that didn't really know what they were doing. No, he chose the best of the best. And even the Lord had commanded him to do this. Look back at verse 1 of chapter 13. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, send thou men, not boys, men, that they may search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers shall ye send a man, not a boy, everyone a ruler among them, verse number 2. He said in Moses, verse 3, and Moses, by the command of the Lord, sent them from the wilderness of Paran. All those men were heads of the children of Israel. So church, think about it. Moses puts this special ops team together. He sends out the best of the best. He sends out the guys that are, man, they're squared away. And he, no doubt, he believes that these men can handle this mission. They're going to go out. They're going to come back, give us the report that we need. That was the game plan. So they go out. Now notice in verse 21, as they get into the land and they spy out the land, look at verse 21. It says, so they went up and searched the land from the wilderness of Zin unto Rehob, as men come to Hamath. Verse 22, it says, the children of Anak were there. All right? These were giants in the land. And so they go in and spy out the land, and now the enemy has been spotted. They're checking everything out. They're getting close to the enemy line, if you will. They notice the enemy. The children of Anak, giants, are there. Now, consider the timing of the events. I find it interesting that first God allows them to spot the enemy. First, God allows them to see the difficulty or the obstacles that were before them. And yes, they're big, they're strong, they're giants. Yes, they could severely hurt us. Yes, they could do us great harm. But church, think about it. God did not allow that to happen. God did not allow the giants to overrun them. Even when they were on their special ops mission, God did not allow the giants to overcome them while they were spying out the land. God kept them safe even when they spotted the enemy. God protected them. Yes, God allowed them to see the enemy. That's important, okay? God was ensuring their hearts and minds that He was going to take good care of them. God was letting them know, hey, I got this. You just be faithful. You do what you've been tasked to do. Psalm 37:23, the psalmist said, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Listen, church, if God is directing our steps, if God tells us to go here or do this or do that, we can know this, that if God is leading us and guiding us, God will protect us. God will see us through. God will bless you and I. And that's what's taking place with these men that are spying out the land. Church, we trust God to lead us every single day. Every day we wake up, we are trusting the Savior. We are depending on Him to lead us and guide us. And He does as we trust Him. Yes, there are enemies out there. There's giants in the land. There's obstacles that we may run up against. There's difficulties that lie before us. But God promises us to be with us every step of the way. Now, church, read your Bibles. God never promised to remove all the obstacles. God never said, I'm going to get rid of all the bad guys for you. God never said, I'm going to take all the things that oppose you out of your way. There's no promise of that in the Word of God. But He did say, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He did say, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and He delighteth in His way. So we have the promises of God that He will go with us, go before us. And if you have God leading you, if God's guiding you, God's protecting you, God's there with you, answer the question, what do you have to be fearful of? Nothing, right? Now, let's admit it. That's easier said than done. Amen? That's easier lived. That's easier preached than lived. But God allowed them to see the giants. God allowed them to see the difficulty. Look at verse 23. And they came unto the brook of Eshcol and cut down from thence a branch with one cluster of grapes, and they bare it between two upon a staff, and they brought of the pomegranates and of the figs. The place was called the brook Eshcol because of the cluster of grapes, which children of Israel cut down from thence. Verse 24. Now, in verse 23, it says, and they came unto the brook. Almost kind of like
They just happened to show up there. Church, I don't believe that was an accident. I don't believe that it was just by chance that these spies ended up where they ended up at. Think with me. Who have they just saw? Giants. Who have they just looked at? Big giant, you know, strong men that could kill us. We're but grasshoppers in their sight, and they could just squash us like a little insect. I mean, no doubt there's probably a little bit of, they might not have been talking about it or admitting it, but probably a little fear in their hearts and minds. And so they've seen the enemy, and now God wants to show them the goodness of the land. Now God wants to show them the blessing of the land. And so he allows them to end up here at the Brook of Eshcol, and God wanted them to get a taste of what was there for them. Now look at verse 23. Notice how large these grapes were that they carried out. They literally had to carry out a cluster of grapes on a staff between two men. Now, I've picked some, you know, some blueberries and some muscadines and figs before. Friend, I can't imagine the type of fruit that was in this promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey, and yet God allowed them to see this, to partake of this. Now listen, don't you think they took a bite while they were over there? Who wouldn't, right? I mean, how many of you ever picked blueberries didn't eat one? No, you eat them. You pick apples, you're going to eat one. Brother Austin, you eat them as you pick them sometimes, right? It's just part of that's how it goes. If you like figs and you're picking figs, you're going to eat a fig, right? You're picking blackberries to make something. You're going to eat them as you pick them. I just have to believe that while they were there and they found that God showed them this great fruit in the land, they were tasting of it while they were there. And they remembered Moses said, hey, I need you to bring the fruit of the land back with you. I need you to bring that back with you. So, I mean, they probably got their bellies full, and they're like, okay, we got to work our way back out of here. They're bringing some back. And so, no doubt, boy, it tasted good. It was a blessing for them to taste of that. Psalm 34:8, the psalmist said, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Church, every one of us sitting in here today, think about it for just a moment, okay? Everyone that's sitting here today, no doubt, has tasted and seen that the Lord is good. Amen? You say, Brother Tim, not me. Okay, let me ask you. Did you get a paycheck last week? Amen. Did it taste good? Amen. Okay, let's try that again. Some of you would like to lose your jobs, I'm guessing. I don't understand. Did you get a paycheck last week? Amen. Amen. Did it taste good? Amen. Amen. You tasted and saw that the Lord was good. The Lord blessed you, okay? Did you wake up to the light of a new day today? Yeah, amen. Did it taste good? Yeah, amen, right? Praise the Lord. Did you have a meal every day last week? I don't think anybody in here is starving, right? Okay. And did it taste good? You might not have enjoyed everything you ate, but for the most part, you understand what I'm saying. You had a meal every day. It tasted good. What tasted good was that God provided for your needs. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Did your family have good health this past week? Hey, listen. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Did your home stay safe last week from vandals and robbers and thieves that would break in and hurt you? Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Did you sleep with a roof over your head this past week? Amen. Yeah, amen. Did it taste good? Absolutely, right? And so, church, if you just stop and think about it, everybody in here has tasted and seen that the Lord is good, okay? All of us. We've all tasted. Hey, when our trust is in God, we're able to taste of the goodness of the Lord in our life. And I believe on a daily basis, yes, there are seasons of subtraction. That's been our Sunday school lesson for 2 weeks. But friend, listen, on a daily basis, God is adding and adding and multiplying and adding and multiplying and adding, and God's blessing and blessing. Yes, He does allow times where we would suffer loss and we go through seasons of subtraction. That is part of the plan sometimes. But friend, listen, even in seasons of subtraction, God is still adding to us. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Now, verse 20, Moses said, bring back the fruit of the land. Moses knew, well, God leading Moses, he knew how powerful of a testimony it would be when they walked in with these giant cluster of grapes on a staff and them, oh boy, them spec ops guys walking in with it. Hey, y'all, look what we brought back, you know, pomegranates and figs and grapes. I mean, we can't even imagine fruit like that. And so Moses knew the impact that would have
in the hearts and the minds of the people that saw that. And so he said, verse 20, you bring that back, the fruit of the land. And no doubt when they brought that back, others would be able to taste that and enjoy that. So 40 days later, verse 20, he said, and what the land is, whether it be fat or lean, he said, be of good courage, bring of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes. So 40 days goes by, and now the 12 spies are going to exfil out of there. They're going to head back home to give their report. Now notice verse 25. When we read these few verses here, it sounds very promising. And they returned from searching of the land after 40 days, verse 25. And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. All right, sounds good. Verse 27. And they told him and said, we came unto the land whither thou sendest us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. I mean, man, you get to verse 27, it's like, everything sounds great. Man, the fruit's amazing. The blessing of God is there. The fruit of the land is unbelievable. I mean, it could take care of us and provide nutrition for our families, and it's a wonderful place flowing with milk and honey. And everything sounds, it sounds like they're just ready to charge over and take the land. It's a great report. Man, this is wonderful. Well, not so much, okay? Unfortunately, that's not what took place. Look at verse 28. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. We saw them giants over there. They got tall walls. They got tall men. I mean, they got a fortified compound that they stay in, and the giants are over there. Church, these elite men, think about it. These elite leaders from their tribe seemingly could not get their eyes off of the giants in the land. I mean, they've got the grapes, they've got the figs, the pomegranates, the fruit of the land. And I mean, you would want to ask them, hey guys, did you taste of the goodness of the Lord over there? Oh yeah. I mean, hey guys, what about the protection you experienced while you were over there? Oh yeah, we're here alive today. I mean, was it that bad? I mean, you're back alive, God protected you. Hey men, what about the promise of God that He said He would protect you? Did that take place? Yeah. And even Caleb speaks up, not wanting to focus on the giants. And look at verse 30. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. Verse number 30. Man, I mean, you get one guy, he speaks up and he's like, hey, we got this. In his mind, his focus was not on the giants. His focus was on God gave us the land. God told us we could have the land. The blessing of God is there. It's the land that floweth with milk and honey, and God has promised us to give it to us. Let's go right now. Can you imagine Caleb's probably thinking, he said at once, we better do this before y'all change y'all's minds. We better head out right now. Let's put a detail together. Let's go over there and whip them giants and put our stake down and claim that property that God's given us before y'all decide to do something different. He said, let's go up at once. And the reply was like, yeah, we hear you. We hear you, Caleb. We hear you that the land was great, the blessings were great, the protection of God was great, but what about them giants? There's giants over there. Look at verse 32. And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched out, the children of Israel, saying, the land though through which we have gone to search it, it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people we saw in it are men of great stature. Oh, they sound so big and powerful. Verse 33. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. Verse 33. Church, I want you to think about the great tragedy here of unbelief. Unbelief. The great tragedy of unbelief. 10 spies. Let me ask you a question. Did the giants hurt y'all when you were over there? Nobody asked the question. Hey guys, let me ask you. Spec up leaders. Did the giants hurt y'all while you were there? Nobody asked that question, right? Hey, but if they would have, I mean, I guess their response would have been, no, they didn't hurt us, but they were big. No, they didn't touch us, but man, they were real tall. Did the giants even pursue y'all while you were over there? You know, they didn't come after us. Matter of fact, they didn't even know we were there, but man, they're big. Hey, if they would have came after us, boy, we'd have been in some big trouble, you know. I mean, did the giants prevent you from tasting of the goodness of the land? No, but man, listen, if they'd have got wind that we were there, you know what? They could have stopped us and they could have prevented us from bringing, woulda, coulda, shoulda, right? All of these what ifs, all of these perceived threats that we see in life, all of these giants that have not touched us, they have not hurt us, they have not pursued us, and yet the perceived threat, think about it, okay? They were saying that a perceived threat was more powerful than an experienced victory. Think about it. You came back alive. You were not pursued. They did not harm you. Hey, God protected you. Matter of fact, you came back alive, and with, you know, you had staff. I mean, you were carrying big old clusters of grapes over with you and the fruit of the land. Man, you came back more than what you left with. Oh, but there's giants over there. There's giants over there. Friend, listen, how is it that a perceived threat can be more dangerous, you know, more powerful than an experienced victory? Here's what happened. They kept their eyes on the giants, and it literally cost them. The giants never hurt them. The giants never pursued them. The giants never opposed them. Don't miss this. Yet the giants won the battle in their minds. And church, I really believe this. So often, God's people, we miss out on the goodness of God because of the perceived threats that we have up here. We miss out on the blessing of God. We miss out on the promised land. Oh, God's got us, and we're saved, and we got a home in heaven, and yeah, when you know all the verses, and that's wonderful, right? But we're missing out on the next level, if you will, that God wants to do for us. Jesus didn't come just to give us life. He said, but to give us life more abundantly. And sadly, this is what happens. We are living beneath that. Man, we're missing out, you know. Well, I woke up today, preacher. I want to do more than wake up every day, man. Hey, listen, I want to do more than just have a taste of the land that flows with milk and honey. Hey, I want to live in it. Friend, listen, I want to bask in it. I want to experience it every single day of my life. Amen. I'm not satisfied with just getting by, you know. That's not that. Maybe you read your Bible differently, friend. And listen, the land that flows with milk and honey, that's not a picture of salvation. Let me just tell you that right now, okay? It's a picture of that abundant life for the child of God. But a perceived threat. Oh, but there were giants. Well, did they hurt you? No. Did they pursue you? No. Did they oppose you? No. Did they keep you from bringing back the fruit of the land? No. Well, then what are we scared of? Like, I mean, what's the problem, you know? Friend, listen. Church, you and I that are here today, we know the goodness of God. We know the blessing of God. God has allowed you and I to taste the grapes of Esco and enjoy the land of milk and honey. We've tasted of it. We know the goodness of God. But if we don't get our eyes off of our giants, it may cost us. If we don't stop looking and listening to the giants, it may cost us. I'm afraid that churches all over are filled with saints who are satisfied with just a taste. They're okay with a taste. I mean, think about the doubters here. Think about the text here. Think about the doubters. All they got was a taste. That's it. And could you imagine those that weren't in the inner circle? Right? These were the leaders of the tribes. These were the head honchos. These were the guys that ran the show, if you will, in the tribes. They were the ones everybody looked up to. I can assure you, not everybody in the tribes got to even taste of those grapes and pomegranates and figs that were brought back. Oh, they heard about it. Well, Daddy said they were good. Mama said it was the best grape jelly she ever had in her life. And man, you know, that's all they got. Some of them did not even get a taste. All because of their parents doubting God. All because that their parents had a perceived threat in their mind. Well, this could happen. That could happen. What if this happens? Friend, listen, when a perceived threat overpowers an experienced victory, listen, we're in trouble. We're in trouble. Deuteronomy 1:28 says this, it says this about the same story. Whither shall we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our heart, saying, and then they told them about the giants in the land. Friend, listen. If you want to have more than a taste, you're going to stop listening to the giants in your life. Hey, there's some negative voices in your life, and there's those individuals in your life that say things that are not helpful for you in your walk with God, that say things that are not encouraging you in your walk with God. There are those individuals that make comments about Christianity, negative comments, that make negative comments about the local church, and all they see is the negative, right? You need to stop listening to those giants. You need to stop looking at those giants. I would say find you some new people to run with, okay? Now, Caleb tried to calm their fears. Then Joshua and Caleb did. Look at chapter 14 and verse 5. I love this story. Man, I love it. I was going back through the Old Testament. When I come across these, they just, man, it's good stuff. Look at Numbers 14 and verse 5. It says, "Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel. And Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb, it says, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes. And they spake unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we passed through to search it is an exceeding good land. If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it us, a land which floweth with milk and honey." Verse number 9. Only man, and listen, when you start preaching the truth to people, they get mad. You know, you can have your little Joel Osteen sermons all you want. Nobody gets their feathers ruffled. Nobody gets upset. Nobody's ever said, "I can't believe Pastor Joel said that." I promise you they don't think that, okay? But look what is said here. They said, "Only rebel not ye against the Lord. Neither fear ye the people of the land." I mean, the leadership, Joshua and Caleb, Moses and Aaron, literally look at the congregation of the people and say, "Hey, listen, don't you rebel against God. Don't turn back from God. Don't go your own way. Don't fear the people of the land. For they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them. And the Lord is with us. Fear them not." Verse number 9. I mean, man, they preached it straight to them. Well, how did they like that, Brother Tim? I'm glad you asked. Looked at verse 10. "But all the congregation bade stone them with stones." They wanted to murder the messenger. They wanted to stone Joshua and Caleb for preaching the truth and looking at the congregation and saying, "You don't need to rebel. You don't need to fear the people of the land. Hey, God's with us. They are bread to us. Even their strength has departed from them." Man, all they did was tell them the truth. And they heard the truth and said, "No, we're gonna stone y'all. We're gonna elect us a new leader. We need another pastor. We need another leadership because we don't want to hear what you have to say because it doesn't fit your agenda." Okay, well, guess what? All you get to do is just taste. And your children might not even get to taste it. Maybe some of you parents get to taste it. And that's a tragedy. Think about it. You've tasted of the goodness of the Lord, and because you won't take your eyes off the giants, your children may not even taste of the goodness of the Lord. Man, that's sad, friend. Not only do I want to taste it and live in it, I want my kids to experience it. I want my children, I want my family to understand what the blessings of God are like. I want my family to understand, listen, the abundant Christian life. Not the Christian life that says, "Well, we're surviving, Brother Tim." No, listen, hey, by the grace of God, we are thriving. We're not just surviving. That's the kind of Christianity that my Bible teaches that we ought to be interested in. Amen. And I'm not some claim it, name it preacher and some prosperity kind of. Listen, I believe in prosperity preaching. Hey, if you live right and do right and honor God, God will prosper you. Amen. That's biblical. Amen. And so, man, he said, whither shall we go? In Deuteronomy, he said, our brethren have discouraged our hearts. Now, church, if we fail to get our eyes, I'm done. If we fail to get our eyes off of the giants. Look at verse 22. You're still in chapter 14. He said, because all those men which have seen my glory and my miracles. Man, they've seen the miracles of God, the glory of God. They tasted, they knew the goodness which I did in Egypt in the wilderness and have tempted me now these 10 times and have not hearkened to my voice. Wow, verse 22. Go down to verse 29. He said, your carcasses shall fall in this wilderness, and all that were numbered of you, according to your whole number, from 20 years old and upward, which have murmured against me. Verse 29, verse 30. Doubtless ye shall not come into the land concerning which I swear to make you dwell therein, save Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun. Friend, listen, what a tragedy. If we do not take our eyes off of the giants, yes, there's enemies. Yes, there's opposition. Yes, there's negative voices around us. But listen, you got to get your eyes off of it. You got to stop listening to it. Listen, you got to trust the word of the Lord. We got to trust the promises of God. Friend, listen, if we do not get our eyes off of the giants, we're going to miss out on the promised land. I'm not saying salvation. Don't take me out of context. I'm not saying you're going to lose your salvation or you're not going to make it to heaven. You're going to miss out on the abundant Christian life because all you got your eyes on is the giants. Oh, but they're big, preacher. You won't believe what I'm up against. Yeah, I will, but is your God the same God that I know? Is your Savior the same Savior I know? Hey, is your Jesus the same Jesus that I read about in the Word of God? Hey, is your Savior the same one that is a miracle-working Savior? If so, and God has promised to bless us and lead us and guide us and protect us, then what are we fearful of, right? Well, Brother Tim, that's just prideful. No, it's not. That's just arrogant, Brother Tim. No, it's not. It's just belief. It's just belief. God told them, the land is yours. The land, it's your, I've given it to you. He said, I swear it to you. It's yours. Go take it. Oh, no, there's giants. They got walled cities. Man, we're like grasshoppers in their eyes. But did they hurt you? No. Did they prevent you? No. Did they even, like, say boo? No. Okay, well, then what are you worried about? Friend, listen. I do not underestimate the power of the voice of negativity. Listen to me. There's some of you in here today, and you're listening to some people. Listen, you got some so-called friends. You got some people that you chat with and talk with. And listen, and it's just little things here and there. Little things here and there. Little seeds of doubt. Little seeds of negativity. Listen, if you keep listening to that, you're going to think the giants are bigger than your God is. And you're going to make a decision that you're going to regret later, I promise you. Friend, listen, don't miss out on the abundant blessings of the Lord. This morning, let's simply say, Lord, I believe you. Lord, I trust you. And Lord, I'm going to keep my eyes off the giants. I know they're there and they're big and they're mean and they're tough. But God, my confidence is in you. Right now, I think in our churches, we've got a, I'm trying to stay away from politics a little bit, but we got a lot of believers and the giants, a certain party, they're scared of them, right? They're scared of the left. They're scared of liberals. They're scared of this group and that group. Friend, listen, who's our focus on, right? Is our focus on the enemy or is our focus on the promises of God? If our focus is on the promise of God, we don't need to fear the enemy. And if God allows them to have their way, well, then that's His plan. What you going to do about it, right? You can't change it. And if you study your Bible, it's got to get worse before it gets better anyway, you know? I mean, I'm praying God will give us a space of grace. I'm praying God will send revival to our hearts and to the local church, but I really think that the church in many ways has really thumbed their nose at God. And we'll see. We'll see what happens. But church, hey, listen, this morning, get your eyes off of your giants. What a tragedy to allow a perceived threat or giant to rob you of the great blessings of God Almighty that He has for you. Let's stand. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Maybe you're here today, you say, Brother Tim, I'm not a Christian. Brother Tim, I've never accepted the Lord as my Savior. Friend, if that's you, I'd love to pray for you this morning. Maybe you've never believed on the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. That's the most important decision that you can make, becoming a child of God, understanding that you're a sinner in need of a Savior, understanding that Jesus, He paid the price on the cross of Calvary, shed His life's blood to pay for your sin, my sin, the sins of all humanity, and all you got to do is by faith trust Him for the salvation of your soul. Just believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Friend, if that's you and you'd like to get saved this morning, like to get that settled, I would love to pray for you. I would ask you just to quietly slip your hand up. Nobody's looking, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. You say, Brother Tim, pray for me. I've never been saved, but I'd like to make that decision. Anyone at all, real quickly, anyone at all. Now, church, you think with me. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but you answer this in your heart and mind. Have you been looking at the giants? Have you been listening to the negative voices around you? Even in your own camp, right? Even among your own people. You need to turn the channel because it's having an impact and an effect on your life
that you might not even realize, and it may cost you the abundant blessings of the Lord God of heaven. Father, bless this invitation, Lord, as we gather around the altar and pray. Lord, I ask you to send revival to our hearts. Lord, forgive us, Lord, of disbelief. Lord, forgive us for doubting you. And Lord, help us to understand the importance of not paying attention to the giants, Lord. We know they're there, but God, we don't have to keep our focus on them. And Lord, may we put our focus and trust on you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Piano's going to play. Let's take a moment and talk to the Lord. If God spoke to your heart, maybe you just want to say, Lord, I trust you. Lord, I'm believing you for a miracle. Lord, forgive me for staring at the giants. Lord, forgive me for listening to the negative voices that are in my life. Lord, help me to find the strength and the courage to walk away from that, Lord, and to change those channels and get different people around me that's not going to be speaking all that negativity. Let's talk to the Lord while the piano plays. If God spoke to your heart, are you satisfied with just a taste? Will your kids even get a taste of the goodness of the Lord? They might not. They might not, depending on the decisions that we make. Others in your family may miss out on it. Let's ask God to help us stay true to the course, stay faithful, and God will bless us for that. Let's talk to the Lord while the piano plays. God bless you, church. If our trust is in the Lord, we do not have to fear what man can do unto us, right? What they can do. Doesn't mean God's going to allow them to do it, but they can do. Well, they're giants. They're strong. Yeah, okay. Well, my God's bigger than they are. So, amen. That's too simple, Brother Tim. Really? Man. I think we complicate living by faith sometimes, and we don't have to. And so I hope we can learn from the children of Israel. And man, not make the same mistakes that they made. We have all this that serves as an example for us. May we read it and heed it and live it. All right, let's have a word of prayer and get you out of here. Enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Meet back tonight at 6 p.m. for the evening service. Be mindful of all the announcements in the bulletin. If you didn't get one, grab one on your way out. Ladies, Ice Cream Social, keep all that in mind. Let Miss Open know if you're coming out for that. And y'all enjoy your afternoon. Father, we love you. Pray dismiss us in safety. Thank you for your word, Lord. Help us, Lord, to trust you. And Lord, not to fear the giants, Lord. Help us to keep our eyes off the giants. But know, Lord, that you're in control. And God, you're going to bless us and take good care of us, Father. May we rest in that promise. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.